the Smith School for organizing this great conference. It's been very interesting yesterday, and hopefully we meet the outstanding level which was yesterday. My name is Anton Godin. I'm an associate professor of economics at Houston University in London and in Jamaica. Too bad for me. I'm presenting this paper with Manuel Campillo from the LSE and Stephen Kinsella from the University of Limerick in Ireland. It's still a work in progress, so any comments and questions are more than welcome. Alright, so I guess I don't need to present this graph to you. However, it is a very important matter for us. So when you see the dynamics of what's going on in renewable energy production, as a macroeconomist, you want to understand what is the dynamics of this and what is the impact of this dynamics on a specific sector is going to have on the other subsectors of the real economy and on the financial sector. And obviously what is going to be very important is not only the dynamics we have observed, but what are the predictions and what are the dynamics we see in the next 10 to 20 years? Because that transition and the way the dynamics are, the speed at which the dynamics are going to evolve, is going to have tremendous effects, both on the real side, in terms of employment, in terms of obsolescence of different techniques, in terms of the structure of the economy, in terms of supply as well, but also on the financial side. As Schumpeter was showing 100 years ago, whenever you have this kind of dynamics observed in one sector, there's going to be financial exuberance about it, and there is the rules for potential bubbles. And the dynamics between the financial side of the economy and the real side of the economy is fundamental to understand this transition. So this is our rapidly why did we think it was important to analyze this? So first of all, it's all about speed. The speed at which the sector grows, the speed at which it enters the financial markets, the speed at which some sectors disappear, and the speed at which all these sectors are going to all these dynamics are going to happen will have tremendous effects on the succeeding or not of reaching whatever targets we find relevant for the climate change and to mitigate climate change. So what we found was very important in order to analyze our these dynamics, we needed a model which allowed us to have endogenous cycles. All of this is happening not because of a shock, it's a decision made by policymakers, made by the industry, to invest or not in green energy or to disinvest or not in conventional energies. So you need to have a theory which explains endogenous cycles, and there we can rely on the work of Schumpeter and Minsky. You need to have an explicit relation between the financial sector and the real sector, and the feedback between the two sectors. The paper here with Tajani et al. Is a paper where we try to analyze this in a concept of Schumpeterian analysis. And we show that when you have a transition like this, you have a long-run dynamics coming out of the real sector dynamics, on which is superimposed short-run fluctuations coming from the financial sectors. Coming out of IPOs, coming out of sector disappearing, coming out of profits disappearing in some sectors. What is also fundamental, and I think which we have touched yesterday, is the phenomenon of lock-in. What happens when assets are being built and they have a life of 40, 50 years, which means we are stuck with these assets, which are going to have an impact on the way that, on the dynamics of the whole system. So what is important for me here is that the long run is composed of short-run decisions, and you need to account for these short-run decisions and the building up of stocks made out of these short-run decisions on the long run. And we can't just assume that the long run is irrelevant or just the short run is important. So it's important to have this connection between the short run and the long run. And finally, what I wanted to see was the contagion effects from the dirty sector or from the conventional sector towards banking financial markets and towards all the other real sectors. And the interactions between what happens in the banking financial market and what happens on the real sector is very fundamental. So this is the motivation for our model. And in terms of macro financial implication, we want to understand where is the money coming from to finance these new green investments? What are the private-public debt dynamics which will happen? Schumpeter was showing, again, 100 years ago, that any innovation has a financial implication because you need to finance innovation. And this financing of this new innovation is going to have an impact on the liquidity of the market. When you create new debt, you have more liquidity in the market, and this has to go somewhere. So it's very important to understand the private-public debt dynamics. And obviously, what are the effects on the assets? what happens when you are stuck with a plant you can't use because it's kind of not important anymore. And we were a bit frustrated with the integrated assessment models because they do obviously a tremendous job at understanding the long run dynamics, but they had some limitations. For example, it's a supply side framework, and in terms of stranded assets, demand is going to be fundamental. You need to understand what happens if the demand for conventional energy stops or is limited by regulations. So the demand side is fundamental in trying to understand the dynamics emerging over there. There is a high level of aggregation, so we don't see the intrasectorial dynamics. What happens if, because of non-performing loans in one sector, there is a credit constraint on another sector? So you need to understand what are the different dynamics emerging in each of these different sectors. And then there's little monetary or financial variables. So that's why we propose this stock flow consistent methodology. It's basically a flow of funds model. Back in the 80s and before that, it was used by most of the central banks. So the idea is that you model all the balance sheets of each sector or subsectors, and you see how the flow variables will impact the stock variables and then generate new flows in the next period. It's very useful to track both financial and ecological variables, and it's very similar in spirit to ecological and macroeconomic system dynamics. So that's the model structure we have on demand side. So what will happen is we're going to have consumption, investment, and government expenditure, which are based on whatever function you find relevant, expectations, so on and so forth. These consumption are based on the past, these behaviors equations are based on the past and expectations. They determine the aggregate demand, which then determines the labor demand, energy demand, and the capital utilization. And then we have modeled specifically the energy market, and I'll come to that in a moment. Obviously, all these demands then generate income, which then generates the consumption, investment, and government expenditure for the next period. So you have these dynamic feedbacks between each period through the stocks. So in terms of the supply of energy, we have distinguished between green energy capacity and dirty energy capacity. But we have one market. So there is only one, and it's very different. I mean, in the real life, it's like that. You don't have two markets for the energy, green energy or dirty energy. You have one market. So what happens is that you have a global demand for energy, and then depending on the condition of the market, more or less green energy and dirty energy is going to be used. The characteristics of the two markets is that the green energy has a higher cost of capital but lower cost of fuels, while the other one is true for dirty. So lower cost of capital for the dirty energy but higher cost of fuels. The market is so we do a let's say a simplification of this market, where the idea is that depending on the demand, some plants will be used or less depending on the variable cost to produce energy in each of the type of plants. So and you have obviously the possibility to have ill capital. So our model is a bit simpler. So we have green energy capacity and dirty energy capacity, and depending on demand, we will use more or less dirty energy capacity. The price is being fixed on the variable cost of the dirty sector plus a markup. So what you see is that depending on how much of the capacity of the dirty energy, they will make or not some profits. So these are the balance sheets of the rest of the economy as we see. So we have household holding deposits and heavy net worth. The deposits are the liabilities for the banks. They provide loans and bonds. The non-financial firms have capital stock, the same as energy firms, and then they finance themselves through loans and return earnings. And the government is playing a very simplistic role for the moment, but still, it emits bonds to finance themselves. So the model is calibrated on the OECD. So we've done a lot of work on trying to get all the data and making sure it's consistent, so there is no loss in terms of flows, in terms of stocks. So we take all the main macro financial variables from the OECD national accounts. We have taken the energy-related variables from the IEA. And we start modeling in 2012, mainly because we have a lack of data for the OECD in 2013-14. So we start with 2012. And we have calibrated all the behavioral function in terms of consumption, which is based on expected disposable income and wealth, investment, which is based on capacity utilization rate and return rate, and we have an issue because the trend in energy investment, in green energy, is too high to understand only in terms of capacity utilization and return, but it has to be there's something else which is going on. So what we have assumed is that there are some subsidies helping the sector to grow, and then we have some scenarios on how these subsidies are going to fade out or not. So this is the baseline as it is. You see, so before the vertical line, this is real data, and these are predictions. And our baseline sees a slight increase in green energy, the black line, which is unfortunate, down there. And you see that its share in terms of production goes towards 13-14% of total energy produced. All right, so then what was the first? We have run some preliminary scenarios on that. For example, what happens if there's a shock of plus or minus 1% on fossil fuels? What happens if the speed at which the subsidies phase out more or less quickly? What happens if there's a consumption shock? And so on and so forth. And depending on all of these different shocks, you have cases where the share of total green capacity going towards, sorry, of the share of, this is the dirty capacity, this is the green production, and you have cases where the green sector disappears completely, or cases where the dirty sector disappears completely. So this, to our understanding, with this very simple model for now, made us believe that we needed to go further and have a more financial sector, because so far the financial sector was fairly, fairly simple. So, going back to the motivations, we needed to understand the speed at which all the dynamics was going to happen and what were the feedbacks we had for that. So we started doing a new model, which is this one, where we have endogenized the interest rates and the non-performing loans, and we have a more realistic financial sector. What am I agreeing with the time? Oh, right. Going very fast. what we have now is, and it's that's the very preliminary part, we have a case where with this endogenous banking sector with more realistic features, what we see is that nonetheless, even if we keep the same subsidy scenarios, there's a good chance that the green energy will be constrained and won't be growing as much as it is. So it seems to us that there is a need to have a more proactive policy in terms of credit access and in terms of financing the green sector than if we keep the way it is. But also, in some cases where this is a scenario where I actually we have increased the propensity to invest by the green sector, we need to understand what's going to happen when these dynamics happens in the dirty energy, when they actually disappear, because that's where the financial sector will suffer more. And here we are, that's where we are, so I haven't been able to go further in there. What we have seen nonetheless is when you have this kind of dynamics in the dirty energy, you have more fluctuations in nominal output. So you know that what we observe is that if we have actually a disappearance of the conventional sector, or if you have a more faster transition towards green energy, we will see more fluctuations in output. And this is fundamental, again, if you want to help the transition and have a more smoother transition towards the green energy. So this is the kind of, for the moment, these are the different feedbacks we have in mind when we talk about stranded assets and we talk about this transition where the conventional sector somewhat shrinks quite a bit. So there's a flow impact, a flow dimension to it, and a stock dimension to it. The first one is there will be a loss of revenues for the conventional sector, which might lead to non-performing loans. And this is when it's interesting, because the non-performing loan will have an impact on the balance sheets of the banks, which will have an impact on the interest rate settings and on the credit constraints that the bank might feel if they have to clean the balance sheets and if they need to restore the net worth then we will see important dynamics coming out of the financial sectors. And these financial impacts will then feed back into the real sectors. What happens if the conventional or the consumption sector is creating constraints? What happens, and that's what we see right now in the financial crisis. So something which is not at all related to the rest of the economy will then feed back into the real side of the economy. And so we want to understand that. And then there's a stock impact, non-performing loans, as I said, impacting the balance sheets, but also the financial crisis. There's a very interesting paper by Spiganti just this year, where they show what happens if the financial crisis evolves and happens, and a financial crisis related to the fact that the stock market capitalization of the conventional sector shrinks dramatically. And then there's another paper on investment constraints. So this is where we want to go. If we want to see all of these different impacts and see how they play back into our model. I'll conclude with different potential scenarios we want to have. So in terms of aggregate demand, the credit concern and recession, which I just described, what happens if the public finance is in crisis? Right now in Europe and in most of the world, the austerity prevails, which will have an impact on, can we have non-conventional support? Can we have financing, support in terms of finance to the investment, which doesn't have an impact on the public deficit? What happens with a steady state or a degrowth scenario? The stranded asset scenarios, which are related to what I just described before, balance sheet impact on non-performing loans, and balance sheet impacts of asset class. The impact on the leverage in the financial crisis in the financial world. And I think that's something which we haven't been addressing yesterday a lot, is if we believe that it's reasonable to decrease the quantity of output produced by the conventional sector, this is going to have an impact on the supply side. What happens if some part of the economy are constrained? And we assume it's something which is realistic. What happens if we, let's assume that we only use 30% or 40% of the fuel reserves? This is going to have an impact on who gets the fuel, what are the impact on the prices. So the supply side and supply constraint is very important to understand. And the difference between support investment through subsidies or carbon taxes, which one is the most efficient in terms of achieving the regrowth we want to see. And then fossil fuels price shock. I think that's pretty much. All right, so just to conclude, as I said, this is a very still preliminary work. We're happy with the first model we have, but it's we feel it needs to be enhanced in terms of financial dynamics. So, but nonetheless, what we can see is that this ecological macroeconomics model provides an interesting story for analyzing ecological transitions, which is fundamental to understand what we're living now. And I think what's important as well is the idea of transition rather than have a crisis. So we are living in a world which evolves all the time. It's really about one state of the economy towards a new state. We're not going back to where we were 10 years ago. It's really about understanding transition. And as such, you need to have a model which explains the dynamics of the transition rather than understanding shocks. We obviously have a focus on the transition of the energy system towards renewable resources, but it could be also on transports or heating systems and so on and so forth. And our three main contributions right now is, first of all, using this new approach to a consistent flow of funds to energy economics, the modeling of explicit modeling of stranded assets in a consistent and coherent framework, the calibration based on the OECD region, and the future scenario and policy recommendations. Thank you.